Lesson 31 is an interview with Dr. Gladys T. McGarey, international author, speaker, physician for over 50 years, and the topic of this lecture will be preventive health care for children internationally.
Hello, I'm Dr. Heather Devich, and I am here with Mission Montessori International, and we're putting together a teaching video with Dr. Gladys McGarey, MD, MDH, and with Laura Blondie, Masters in Education in Montessori Education and Hospital Administration. And we are going to be interviewing today Dr. Gladys McGarey because of her whole lifetime of wonderful experience with holistic health. She is known in medical circles and worldwide as the mother of holistic health. And she is not only been a physician for all these years, she's an author, she's a world traveler, and a speaker at so many different venues. And she has just retired after 56 years of practice, and now she's getting ready to go to Afghanistan to help set up a medical clinic with another doctor. And this fascinating woman has so much to share, and we would like to have her share with us for our teacher training center so that we can help mothers of the world find ways in simple, good, practical ways that they can be helping their own families to maintain their health, maybe some simple things that they could do if someone gets ill. But we need to start out with her wonderfully fascinating life. Laura, I think you have some things you want to know about Dr. Gladys.
Yes, I do. Dr. Gladys, I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit about your childhood and what people that you think most influenced your character and your studies.
Well, my parents, of course, influenced me. I was born and raised in India, and the fun of it is that my mother went into labor at the Taj Mahal when she first saw the Taj Mahal, so that was just an interesting interlude. But I grew up in northern India. My parents did their medical work back in, we lived in tents in the jungles, and they took their medical work back to the people back there. Many of the people, as I grew up, had never seen a white person before, and so they had all kinds of reasons why we were white. One of their favorite ideas was that as soon as we were born, my mother put us in white cotton and soaked up all the color. And they used to come and rub my skin to see if the color would come off. But I loved growing up in India. It was, for me, it was, you know, there was nothing exotic or strange about it. It was life.
Why were you there? What were your parents there?
They were medical missionaries there. And they were both physicians. And so they took their medical work, like I said, into the jungles, into the where the people lived. And so that's where we grew up. And I came to the States when I was 16 to start college and then went to medical school, planning to go back out to India. But in the meantime, I got married and had my family, and so I stayed here. But my family stayed in India. Mm-hmm. And my parents were there until I think they retired four times or something. You know, they would simply feel like they had to go back, and they'd go back. But they went in conjunction with my aunt, started a home for the children of leper parents. And there are thousands of children who grew up in that home who are now influential people across India. Mm-hmm. The reason being that if the child stayed with their parents, they would get leprosy and wouldn't be, and they would then be beggars with the others. But if they were taken and the parents would bring them to the children's home, then they had an education. And the problem is that very often in India, if they were known as the children of lepers, they had no future. But because they were raised in this home and were completely separated, they are doctors and nurses and so on. In fact, my nephew married one of the girls from the children's home. So his in-laws are lepers, which I think is just great. So it's that kind of a background that I grew up in, and always knew that medicine was the path I needed to take. I mean, there was never any question about that. So that's what I studied for, you know, so that I would be able to do that. But my path took another turn, which is the way life is.
Do you mind if I ask you about the story with the elephant in India?
Not at all. Among other things, and mostly my parents took care of people. But this one day, my dad was off with my brothers on a hunting trip because we did hunting. There were animals that were in the jungle that attacked the people, and they would come and ask my folks my dad particularly, to help with that. And so Dad and my brothers were off on a hunting trip, and Mom was the doctor in charge. And a Mahout, who is the elephant boy, came with the elephant, which had been injured. The elephant had a bad sore on its left front foot. What had happened was that during one of the tiger hunts, the leopard had stepped on a stump and had gotten a big splinter in its leg, and they had taken care of it as best they could, but it had gotten infected, and they just didn't seem to be able to help it. So they came to ask my mother, who didn't know what in the world she was going to do with an elephant, but she got some potassium permanganate solution and syringed the leg, and then was able to extract a large splinter out of its leg. And the elephant was so pleased with this whole process that he just fell in love with my mother. And the rest of the time they were there, he followed her around. In fact, she'd be doing something and she'd feel this trunk around her waist, and she'd say, "Now stop it." And the elephant would let go, but it would follow her around. It was just really exciting for us as kids. I was about 8 or 10 years old, and it was just a really, really exciting thing to remember that, you know, the fact that she was able to actually help that elephant when she was there to do whatever else she was to do.
Thank you.
Did your parents really mentor you to be a doctor, or did that drive come from inside of you?
Well, you know, that's what I saw. But I have one brother that's a physician, and then me too. My other brothers didn't go into the field of medicine. So it was something I came in to do, and I just knew that.
Mm-hmm. So how old were you when you decided to become a physician?
Oh, I guess about 2.
Wow.
My daughter Helene did the same thing when she was 2. She said she was a doctor.
Did your parents practice under?
Well, we moved every couple of weeks back into the jungle, so we just pack up the tents and go on back. And they had the medical tent out of which they did most all of their work. So they pulled teeth, sewed up lacerations, did whatever was necessary. A lot of malaria, so they used a lot of quinine. People with all sorts of illnesses came. A lot of malnutrition, a lot of intestinal problems, you know, just normal physical stuff that people get. And so they would spend their mornings and early afternoon working with people, and then the evenings were dedicated to their mission work, which was talking about the life of Christ and other areas of work that they felt they could share with the people. So it was great.
So where did you actually live?
Intense, in the jungle. That was during the winter months. Mm-hmm. In the summer, we were in the Himalayas at school.
In the school?
Yeah. We had a home up in the, not in the high Himalayas, but it was 8,000 feet. And we went to school at Woodstock, which was a school that was created for the children of missionary families, but it's still very active. It's an international school in northern India.
Still functioning now?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, very active. Yeah.
Well, now you said, now obviously your mom had a big influence on you. How about, you were mentioning your aunt, how about your aunt?
Well, my Aunt Belle was my father's sister, and she was a physician too, and a real dynamic person who talked to God like he was a close buddy, and I'm sure he was. And so Aunt Belle was very important, of course my parents. But our Aya, who was the Indian nurse, who was kind of like a nanny mm-hmm. for us, we loved her very dearly, and she loved us. She was very important, and Dar was her husband. He was the cook, and they were, it was all family. You know, this was all part of our family, and we loved them very much. The Bible woman was part of the whole mix, and it was a good way.
How about the story, though? Like Aya, or Aunt Belle? How about the wolf story?
How about what?
The wolf story.
Well, my second brother, who is also the physician, when he was 8 months old and my older brother was about a year and a half, well, he was two, excuse me, we were out in camp. I mean, they were out in camp. I wasn't born. Mm-hmm. So my parents were in the camp in the jungles, and my two brothers, Carl was about 8 months old, and my older brother John was two and a half or three. And my folks went into the little village to do one of their lantern lectures. And John was in the top bunk, and Carl was in the bottom bunk of their double-decker bed. And the Aya had dozed off to sleep and was leaning against the bottom bunk when she got jolted awake. And when she woke up, she saw a she-wolf with her mouth open above Carl's head, just ready to carry him off. She picked up a shoe and threw it at the wolf, and the wolf just looked at her. She picked up one of the sun helmets, the topies, and threw it and just looked at her. And she finally began to clap her hands and yell. The dogs came running, and the wolf went out the back of the tent. So that by the time my folks came back to the camp, everything was in a big uproar, and my mother said, yeah, well, that thing's been coming in the last three nights. And my dad said, what do you mean? And she said, yeah, it's been coming in the back the last three nights. And he said, what'd you do? She said, I took a pill and told it to get out. And she shooed out, and my dad said, why didn't you tell me? She said, you wouldn't believe me. So anyway, he sat up the rest of the night waiting for the wolf to come back, and she did. But he could never quite get a bead on it, so the next day they left. But the wolves do pick up children in India. I mean, that Romulus and Remus story mm-hmm. is probably a real story. Mm-hmm. And there are children who have been found in India who were raised by wolves. So this brother of mine who's had such an effect on so many lives
could have been a wolf child.
Yeah, and then you wanted the story about Aunt Belle. Well, Aunt Belle was my dad's sister, and Aunt Belle was a powerful lady. And she, along with my folks, did start the children's home. But when it was first starting, the way it got started was that my Aunt Belle was in South India, and one morning, the mill workers were going to work, and they heard what sounded like a baby in the cactus. So they put boards down and went back in and found this newborn little baby girl, because her parents had wanted a boy, and found out it was a girl, they threw her in the cactus hedge. Okay, so the mill workers put boards down, went back in, picked up the baby, and took her to the policeman. They didn't want her. So they sent her to the mission, and my aunt spent 2 hours picking cactus thorns out of her little body, and then she developed pneumonia. After that, Aunt Belle came up north where we were, and over a period of time started this children's home. But at one point, somebody had given Aunt Belle some chickens, and that was great, because then they had eggs and they had some chicken now and then. And one night when everybody was quite sound asleep, she heard a commotion out in the chicken coop. And when she went out, there was a jackal that had one of the chickens in its mouth, just about ready to scoot off of that chicken. Well, that wasn't anything, and well, that's ready to have happen. So she stood there. She had in her hand a flashlight, and she said, "In the name of Jesus Christ, drop that chicken." And the jackal dropped the chicken and got away, and Annabelle saved her chicken and the whole flock, you know.
With a flashlight.
And with a flashlight and her finger. Her finger was very intimidating, I can tell you, I know.
How about your father?
My dad was a wonderful Scotch Presbyterian doctor preacher person, and he's the one who really, you know, he did, of course, he's the one who taught my brothers how to hunt and all of that kind of thing, but he was he's the one who just would never let us quit. I mean, two things that were, you just didn't want to hear from my dad. One was, "Is that a lie?" Or, "Are you a quitter?" The two were a par. Those were not tolerated.
Now, your father took you out to hunt before you came in?
Yeah, we all had to have a go-round. That was part of sort of a rite of passage.
Well, how about, let's see, you must show us the things that are living in. Tell us the story of how it works.
Well, the tiger was shot by my dad. It was a man-eater. And so my dad bagged that one out in the jungle. And the leopard over here is the one that I shot, so.
So you shot this leopard. Tell us about that.
Well, that's too bad for you.
Wow.
Dr. Gladys, could you tell us about the process that helped to develop your medical skills?
Well, you know, of course it takes going to medical school and learning to read and write and do all of that stuff.
Right.
So school is part of the process.
Did you go to high school in India?
Went to high school in India. Came to the States for college. It went to Muskingum College in Ohio, which happens to be where John Glenn went.
is it a Presbyterian college?
United Presbyterian at the time. All of us went there, my brothers and my sister. And so it's a very fun college in Muskingum, Ohio. And I did my pre-med work there, and then I went to Women's Medical College in Philadelphia during the war, and actually met Bill just as I was starting medical school. I met him in his uncle's church in Cincinnati, and then we got married during the time that we were in medical school. He was in medical school in Cincinnati, and I was in Philadelphia. So we didn't have much time together at that point, but that wasn't unusual because other people, my other classmates' husbands were overseas, so I felt very fortunate. And when I finished medical school, I did my internship in Ohio, where Bill was finishing up his medical school. And I was the first woman intern at the Deacon's Hospital in Cincinnati, so there really wasn't a place for me to stay. They had headquarters for men interns,
right,
but they didn't have any place for women. And so what I had was the X-ray table, and it worked out okay. But it was pretty uncomfortable. But there was a resident who really knew three things. One, he knew women didn't belong in medicine.
Mm.
Two, he knew pregnant women didn't belong in medicine, because at that point I was pregnant with my first son. And three, he knew that I didn't belong in medicine. So his purpose in life was to get me out, which of course made my purpose in life that he would not do it. And I literally would have died hadn't been for one of the angels that God sends into my life when he sees I'm in trouble. See, I think he looks down and he says, he's in trouble again, and then sends an angel. So I was, this resident would schedule me for surgery at the earliest surgery in the morning, which was 7:30, which meant that there was no way I could get anything to eat before that. And he always scheduled me for the longest surgeries, which were usually orthopedic, which usually took about 5 or 6 hours, so it meant that there was no way I could get anything to eat during that time. So, you know, it was a matter of, hang on, kids, you're not going, you're not passing out now. And then all of a sudden the schedule began to change, and I didn't know why it was changing, so much to his dismay and trying to figure out why it was changing, I didn't know. Until about 3 o'clock one morning when I was on call, I looked down the hall and here was little Lucille, this little black maid who'd pulled a chair over to the blackboard, and she was erasing Carl Ferber's name down below and mine and putting Carl's name up on top and mine down below. And I know she saved my life. You know, I really know that she literally saved my life. So that I got my internship there, and then Bill and I moved to Wellsville, Ohio, which was his hometown, where he had grown up. And so we stayed there and worked in that little town. Actually, when we moved there, there were 8 other doctors there, but during the time that we were there, 2 of them died. 1 of them was called back into the service. Bill was called back into the service. And by the time we left, there were just 3 of us, and 2 of them. One was a physician from Latvia who had been really severely traumatized, and so he couldn't handle too much stress. And the other one was a physician who had had a heart attack and couldn't handle a lot of stress, so that was me.
So there you were. So how many children?
The 4. Yeah, I had the 4 by then.
4 children in the whole town.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So by the time I left, I was ready to go. Bill had come out here to Arizona and fell in love with it. And so we came out to Phoenix in 1955. And it was just a small little town at that point, you remember? And my 2 youngest children were born here.
So a total of 6 children. So as soon as you came to Arizona, did you start here?
Well, I had to get my license. Bill had already gotten his license to practice here, so he started first. And then when I got my license, Bill had a small office down on the corner of 40th Street and Thomas, which then was a 2-lane road. So he had a little office there, and then when we started together, which was the next year by the time I got my license and Helena had been born, we started at the corner of 56th Street and Indian School, behind a little pharmacy there. So that's where we practiced until we started the ARE clinic on 40th Street, just below Indian School. And that started after we got interested in the education material, which was really pivotal in guiding our medical work into aspects of holistic medicine, which is actually the concepts of holistic medicine come directly from the education material.
Okay. And I think it seems to me that the holistic medicine is so pervasive now that people can hear a lot of that history. Could you tell us some of the history of where the term holistic came from and how it developed?
Well, we, Bill and I, of course, were very interested in many things, including nutrition and the effect that prayer had and so on. And then Edgar Casey's material, Hugh Lynn Casey, who was Edgar Casey's son, used to come to town and he'd say to us, why don't you guys do something with the physical readings in the exegesis? We'd say, oh, Hewlett, your dad was psychic and kept changing things. I mean, no 2 people were treated with the same disease, were treated the same way. We're not psychic, we can't do that. So he'd go away, and next year he'd come back and he'd say, why don't you guys do something with the physical readings? We'd say, Hewlett, we're not psychic, you know, just kind of go away. And this went on for several years until we got it. And what we finally understood was that what Casey was talking about was not diseases. Diseases happened to be part of the picture, but he was talking about basic physiological principles. And when we understood that, then we were able to begin to work with the Casey material. When he started talking about castor oil wasn't just something to be used as a poultice. Castor oil was something that changed the way the lymphatic system worked. And if the lymphatic system was cleaned up, the body worked better. So, of course, there were disease processes that you could work with when you were doing, when you were using castor oil as a poultice. And he talked about the coordination between the kidney and the liver. Now, in medical school, we weren't taught anything about that. And yet, common sense tells you that you have to have that cooperation, that coordination, or you don't get a healthy body. He talked about things like the consciousness of the cells. He said every cell in the body has its own consciousness. And we began to think about that. We began to realize that dreams were pivotal in the way a person healed, the way a person dealt with things. He asked questions like, what do you want to get well for? Unless you have an ideal, unless you have a purpose, unless you have something to work towards, why are you trying to get well? And these are questions that are basic to the concept of holistic medicine. And so the more we thought about this, the more we realized that there was something here that was missing in medicine. So there were a number of us who were, actually Bill had started a little newsletter that he called Pathways to Health. And he had started sending these around to physicians across the country who were cooperating doctors with the education material. And in 1967, there was a physician up in, a gynecologist up in Idaho by the name of John George. And he wrote to us and he said, there are enough of us who are interested in this. Why don't you put together some kind of a program? So in 68, we started the symposium, which we had then for over 20 years. And that was really a pivotal program in changing the face of medicine, because people like Norm Shealy and Christiane Northrup and Bill Tiller and Shafia Karagula, all these people who are beginning to look into these aspects of medicine, we had them come and present at the symposium. And that went on every year for 20 years. And really, the American Holistic Medical Association is a spin-off of that. The Academy of Parapsychology and Medicine started. Actually, that's kind of an interesting story, because one must have been about 1970, something like that. Because we just gotten interested in acupuncture, which incidentally started the first acupuncture symposium in the country here in Phoenix. But anyway, Bill and I had decided we needed a weekend off, so we went down to Apache Junction for a weekend by ourselves. And Bill woke up in the morning and he said he had a dream. And the dream was that he was coming down a set of stairs, and Hewlett and Casey was standing at the foot of the stairs and said to him, you need to start the Academy of Parapsychology and Medicine. That was a dream. And so we talked about it and thought, that's a good idea. And so as we talked about it, we said, well, who should be present? We had just read Bob Bradley's book on husband, coach, childbirth, and we thought, he's a good guy. So we wrote to him and said, told him what we were thinking. And he got a letter, a six-page letter back, and the first three pages were why he couldn't do it. In the middle of the third page, it said, well, why not? And the last three pages were why he could. So that started the Academy of Parapsychology and Medicine, and we had programs all up and down the West Coast where we did, and there were thousands of doctors that came We were talking about acupuncture. Greens, Elise and Elmer Green, were talking about biofeedback. Shafia Karagula was talking about the importance of consciousness. You know, it was just one thing after another. And then as a result of that, we then started the AHMA, American Holistic Medical Association. And it's been a very important factor in where medicine has gone through the years.
How did you decide on the term?
Well, it took us 2 years. After we started the, there were five of us who started the AHMA, and we started with, the first meeting was in Denver in 1978, and Norm Shealy was president, I was vice president, and then after that, for 2 years, we tried to come up with how we were going to spell holistic, whether it was with a W or an H. When we finally realized that the word holistic is the same root word as holy, as health, as healing, we decided that's what needed to be done. It was not the W, it was the H. And that's the word that has stuck through the years.
I'm very interested in what you said about acupuncture. Because I know you did it with my children and with my youngest daughter. I had acupuncture in the hospital with you, and I understand at that time that you were the only doctor who legally could do acupuncture in the American hospital. What was the path of acupuncture for you?
Well, we got interested in acupuncture. Actually, that's kind of a long story, but Bill and I got interested in acupuncture and began corresponding with some physicians in Japan and in Europe, and began having some of them come over and talk to us about it. Like I said, we had the first acupuncture symposium at the medical at County Medical Society here. They didn't know what was happening. That was in 72. And at that program, one of the doctors was talking about using acupuncture for deliveries, and so I got the information from him and was able to get permission from the physicians at the hospital where I was delivering babies, Doctor's Hospital, to use acupuncture for my deliveries, and. Nobody knew what to do about it, really. And so I began using acupuncture. And it was wonderful.
Certainly.
Yeah.
So how about delivering, how about the whole aspect of delivering babies and husbands?
Well, it took us,
wives.
Yeah, it took us 12 years to get husbands in the delivery room. You know, it was something that wasn't being done. But then, women were having their babies at home, and when they got into trouble, they'd call us. And so, at one point, this must have been in the mid-70s, I was doing a lecture at Lee Summit, the Unity headquarters in Lee Summit, Missouri. And in the middle of the lecture, I said, you know, I think, you know, women are having their babies at home whether we like it or not. And I think what we really need is something that would be like a baby buggy or a van or something so that we could have the equipment available if the mother or the baby got into trouble so that we could take them to the hospital and get whatever we needed in the way of help. And I went on with that for a little bit, and then after I finished the lecture, a woman in the audience came up and handed me a $100 check and said, get started. So. It took a while, but we got this van that we put together that had the equipment, had an incubator for the baby, had IV equipment, had the equipment so that we could transport. We even had one of the first cellular phones, you know. And then the midwife that I was with at the time, she or I would drive it to the home and do the delivery, and it was. It was an innovative thing that really helped to get to move the whole consciousness of the family being involved in the delivery process.
Right, which is everywhere. Yeah. And how the whole thing with nurse midwives, I mean, yeah. You were really pivotal in even beginning that huge movement.
Well, Barbara Brown was one of the first midwives in the state, and Edna Germain had the number two license for nurse practitioners in the state. And she worked with us for years, so, yeah.
Mm. So, which area of medicine has meant the most to you?
It's all of it, you know. I love sewing up lacerations and doing stuff like that, but deliveries are my joy. But then working with people with chronic illness, which a lot of people don't like to work with, but I love that. And helping people with their dreams, helping them get some kind of focus on where their life is going, has been really wonderful.
I know, having been called in Mother Holistic Medicine, you've also been called the doctor of last resort. is that what you mean? People with really serious illnesses, you can't get.
Well, we've said that the Mayo Clinic rejects come
down. So what do you think that you do differently for all the years of your practice than from other doctors?
Well, one of the things that patients say is that we listen to people, you know. And I think one of the aspects of this is that I don't work with diseases. I work with people who happen to have diseases. And that's quite different. If you're working with diseases, it's not nice. it's a real problem. But when you're working with people, there's hope, there's always hope there. And the people are the ones who are dealing with the diseases. And I know, and the patients that I work with know, that I'm not the one who's doing the healing. My job is to support them and work with them and coach them and help them as they do their own healing process. In fact, my oldest son, who's an orthopedic surgeon now up in Washington State, when he finished his training, his residency and everything, he came through town here. He said to me one day, he said, "Mom, I'm really..." He said, "I'm going to have people's lives in my hands. I don't know if I can handle that." And I said, "Well, Carl, if you think you're the one who has the healing, you have a right to be scared. If you can understand, though, that it's your job to use all your training and do the very best that you know how to do, and then support the patient as they do their healing, you have nothing to be afraid of." Now, I don't know if he remembers that. But, you know, you teach your kids what you need to learn. So I think that's really important. And one of the interesting things that's happened in the last few years has been about 2 or 3 years ago, I was talking to some of you about the fact that what had happened in medicine was that it had become a killing machine. We kill bacteria, we eradicate AIDS, we eliminate diabetes. Women even talk about fighting osteoporosis like you're going to fight your own bone. Our language is against life itself. It's antibiotics, antidepressants, antihistamines. The one that really gets me is the anti-aging, like we're not supposed to get older. But the whole concept is focused towards killing. And one of the things that we'd better learn pretty soon is that you don't end war by creating war. World War I was supposed to be the war to end wars, and look where we are now. You don't teach a kid not to hit by hitting. I mean, it just doesn't work that way. So, and the PDR in 1955, physician's desk reference, was this fast. You know how it is now? So the more you try to kill illness, the more ammunition you need to fight the illness, and you create more illness because of just the principle of the whole thing. It doesn't work. So we were talking about this, and I said, you know what we really need instead of killing medicine is living medicine. And if you're alive, you're going to have illness, you're going to have pain, You're going to have diseases. You're going to die. But you're also going to have joy, and you're going to have hope, and you're going to have love, and you're going to have faith. All of these things are part, but you're going to be alive enough to know that you've got them. And one of the things we've done in our culture is to try and suppress everything so that people don't even feel it. I mean, we have more pain medicines than anything else. I'm not opposed to pain medicines, believe me. But that's not our primary purpose, is to kill pain. But that's what we were taught.
Visualization. I know that's considered a woo-woo thing now, and I think it's used pretty much in most cancer clinics now. You were pretty much a pioneer of having people use visualization in their own healing, too.
That's Casey's work. That's Carl Simonton's work, and Carl Simonton was one of the people who first came to the symposium. It's Elmer and Elise Green's work. You know, it's the whole concept that, and you know, it's what Casey talked about. Thoughts are things. What a man thinketh, so is he. It's biblical. It's part of the whole process.
It's quantum physics.
Yeah, it's part of the whole process of evolving life.
With your patients also, what other things have you used? What other kinds of massage?
The thing that we're so aware of is that it has to be a body, mind, and spirit combination. And you have to feed the body right, which gets you into the whole concept of nutrition. You have to feed the mind properly, which gets into the whole concept of what our mind, what we think about, what we dwell on. And you'd better feed the spirit, or you don't have anything to work on with the body and mind. So the whole concept of properly nurturing the total being, and the importance of a person taking care of themselves. One of the things that is hardest for mothers to do is to realize that if they don't take care of themselves, they can't really take care of their children. Now, that doesn't mean sitting around and eating bonbons. That's not really taking care of yourself. But being aware that there are times when you need rest, there are times when you need to play, that the balance of life is so important. And when we're caught up in just the everyday survival, it's very hard to think about that. But as we do begin to put that into context with who and what we are, it becomes important.
I know, body, mind, and spirit, you mentioned you were one of the first people, well, probably the first clinic that had that as part of their logo.
Yeah.
And what kind of flack did you get for having that concept, which is everywhere now?
Yeah. Well, people didn't understand it. They really didn't. They didn't know what we were talking about. And they just thought it was interesting. I don't think that logo in itself caused much trouble. We were considered very strange, you know, very, I've been called a witch doctor and a lot of other things, so it's, but then, you know, it takes time. When people don't understand something, they criticize it and they put it down. When they begin to understand it, the criticism is less. Mm-hmm. So it's a process of being aware that people don't understand.
But you were also one of the first doctors who advocated the importance of nutrition and its balance. You were talking about how nurturing that.
Well, it took us a long time to get whole wheat bread into the stores, but but we worked with our patients. You know, we'd tell them, when you go into the grocery store, ask where the whole wheat bread is, and they, you know. So it took a while, but you got to understand that Adele Davis was on the scene at that time too, and a lot of her work, and health food stores were beginning to crop up here, there, and everywhere. And people were, see, one of the things that I know is that so much of my education has come directly from my patients, because patients, we don't have a stupid population, you know. We have a population of people who read, and now with the internet, I mean, come on. But even then, they read and thought about things, and they came in and asked questions, and their questions, I felt, needed to be answered. And if I couldn't find, if I didn't know the answer, I'd better get it, because these were honest questions and deep seeking questions. So that was really important. So nutrition became very important. Nutrition for children became very important. One of the things that also we became aware of was that, again, it fits into the concept of living medicine. You don't just kill bacteria when a child has a cold. You know, just to give them an antibiotic to kill the bacteria just creates more problems. And so we became aware that there are times when you need to do an antibiotic. But a lot of times you can use garlic oil in a patient's ear, in a baby's ear, to ease an ear infection. A lot of times the ear infections are directly associated with the molars coming in. And if people don't understand that, they'll treat for an infection when it's really an inflammation as a result of the molar. You give a child something good to bite down on or something to numb the gum, and it will ease a lot of this. One of the things that Casey suggested for respiratory problems with children was the stuff that he called camphoderm, which is something that you rub on the child. You milk out the lymph nodes on the neck and in the chest and low back, and a lot of times a child with a really severe infection gets over the infection by doing that, by a good back rub, by the mother being able to use some of these methods. Another thing that Casey talked about all the time, and which we incorporated early on into our practice, was massage. And at that point, massage was considered something that was done in massage parlors. So to get a therapeutic massage that was actually a medical procedure put into a medical practice was, we felt, very important. Knowing full well that massage is one of the first therapeutic modalities since the beginning of time. You know, people have always known that touch was important, that the working with the body was important.
Well, you combine that therapeutic touch with prayer, which I think pretty much there's all kinds of research that's totally accepted now.
Yes,
without a difficult thing to get people to accept.
You know, I don't know whether it was or not. We did it. Now, I didn't say to the person, unless it seemed appropriate, that we're going to pray about this. But there were times when we'd say, you know, this is something that we'll take to prayer and work with it. But I don't know that the prayer. I think the people in this country, most of them, understand the importance of prayer. I mean, whether they accept it or not, they understand the importance. Putting it together with a medical concept was another whole thing. And so that was something that seemed so natural to us that we just did it. And I think when you're coming from a place of confidence from within yourself, others accept that. You know, it's a matter of, it wasn't a question for me as to whether this was going to work or not. It was, yeah, I mean, this is worth, you know, let's just take this to prayer.
It sounds to me like what you're saying, like the patient's intention meeting the therapist or the doctor's intention, and you can call that a sort of prayer.
Yeah, there are all kinds of, yeah. Yeah.
Through touch.
And concern, you know, to have a physician who really cares about you, not the disease, but you, makes a difference.
I've heard so many people say that when they come into your office, they feel just wrapped in love. Could you describe what you do in your office?
No. Not really, because it's it's like trying to describe how you breathe. You know, there are certain things that you just naturally do. And so I don't know how I would explain that. I usually give my patients a hug because and try to make sure that when they are in my office, they are the most important thing in the world, that's where life is.
Then how do you encourage your patients to help take an active role? I know one of your latest publications is The Physician Within. How do you get your patients to look at the physician within them?
One of the things is asking them what they want to get well for. The other thing is to really get a history, really listen to what they're saying, you know, because the patient will usually tell you exactly what's going on. And the other aspect of that is to pay attention to their dreams. And we spend a lot of time working with dreams.
How do you do that?
I ask them what their dreams are. And if they say they don't dream, I say, well, let's start dreaming now. And so I ask them to get a dream journal and begin to record their dreams. And say, for instance, a person is trying to decide what type of therapy they should use, whether they should use chemotherapy or surgery or radiation or other natural means or whatever. What I ask them to do is to make the best possible conscious decision that they can make. Take into consideration all of the factors. Make the best possible conscious decision they can make. And then pray about it. What I do is pray about it and say, okay, God, this is what I've decided. Is it right? And see what you get in the way of a dream. If the dream is a go-ahead dream that says everything is fine, then you go ahead with what your decision is. But if it's a total disaster dream, you can back up and say, okay, that wasn't a good idea. Maybe if we change it this way and present that to your dream self and see what you get. So it becomes a work in progress as you make these decisions. And it really is helpful to get in coordinating body, mind, and spirit, and getting the direction from the position within you that allows you to know what it is that you should do.
Well, along those lines, could you also tell us in layperson's terms, what do you think are the bodily systems that mothers should be aware of to help promote and protect their health and the health of their families?
Well, they're so basic, you know. There's basic hygiene. In some countries, that's very difficult to do. There's basic nutrition, which is very hard, particularly when indigenous people begin to take on the culture that we take over, which becomes very hard. Our way of eating and the nutrition that we think is good nutrition is not necessarily the best nutrition for the people who have lived for eons of time with a certain kind of nutritional intake. Mm-hmm. So I think trying to understand what it is in their diet that is important and that works for them is vital. Trying to help people understand that just basic hygiene is important is vital too. And then of course the whole business of allowing themselves to play. And children know how to play. In countries where there's so much war and so much pain, it's very difficult for them to learn and to know anything about play. But I think those of us who understand the importance of it should encourage that. I think that the mother's nutrition is absolutely vital, and most mothers will give up everything for their child, which is understandable. But if she can understand the importance of keeping herself healthy in order to keep her family healthy, that's really important too. And the having good water is so vital. You know, there are ways of purifying water that, we've got the solar products that will really help to purify water in countries all around the world that would be very helpful. But without water, it doesn't really make a lot of difference what you what you're trying to do. So what I grew up with was boiled water. All the water that we ever drank was boiled water. And the problem is when you get up to places like Tibet, where it's 14,000 feet, the water boils before it can really kill the bacteria, so that could be a little bit of a problem. But you have to find out what works for different people at different places.
Which is only like 160 degrees, right? That people can get with a solar cooker.
So those are things. And then, you know, people know the importance of the proper care of the skin. And in countries like India, the use of oils, olive oil, almond oil, all of these oils are used all the time. Even if a child can't get good nutrition, they will oil the baby down really well. And the skin soaks that up. Mm-hmm. So they get nutrition in ways that don't require Johnson's baby oil.
Mm-hmm. How about exercise?
Well, most people in most countries have to exercise because it's a survival thing. In our country, we're spoiled enough that we use cars and so on, and we don't exercise. But exercise is something that is so much a part of people's everyday lives. I mean, the women in India carry the sticks on their heads, and they have these wonderfully strong backs and strong necks, but they work all the time. The men don't work as hard, but the women and the children have to. It's part of what they have to do.
What about the role of respiration, oxygen in your whole system?
Well, clean air is something. One of the things that in Tibet when we were there, they have tremendous numbers of people with tuberculosis, and I think one of the reasons is because they live in these small houses because it's so cold, and they use kind of a peat to burn, and that smoke is inside the house, you go into the house, and it's so heavy with that smoke that it's not healthy. And they're afraid of the spirits that might come in during the night, so they don't open their windows and trying to get them to understand that fresh air is vital to good health. And that keeping warm, physically warm, is important, but getting their air moving through their house is vital. One of the sad things is that many countries have taken up smoking. And so you find the cigarette smoking, like in China, it's huge and still is very, very much a part of what they do. So unfortunately, it's one of the things that people have picked up and really work with. But knowing that clean air or breathing. Now, of course, you get in India, where yoga is so much a part of what they do, they know the importance of breath. Mm-hmm. But having the air that is clean enough to breathe becomes another thing. And Delhi, fortunately, they're clearing up a lot of the pollution in Delhi. But India is horribly polluted, just like Mexico. The air is just... And China, because they burn coal in China, and so the air is... dreadfully polluted. So the more we understand about clean air, the healthier people will be.
And its relationship to exercise, too.
Yeah.
But what about the role of, once you have good nutrition, once you have enough rest and good attitudes and you have some good oxygen going, then what about eliminations of waste products?
Well, Native people understand how important that is. We're the ones who don't want to talk about it. But getting enough water to keep the kidneys active is so essential. And keeping the bowels moving is absolutely pivotal to good health. And mothers know that. I mean, mothers can get obsessed by their children's bowel habits. But so the elimination process, of course, we have four major systems of elimination: the kidneys, the bowels, the lungs, and the skin. And they have to work together. If the bowels aren't working properly, the skin won't work properly. A lot of the skin problems are really not skin problems, they're bowel problems. And once you get the bowel active, the skin clears up. So this is, again, one of the things that Casey talked about, the coordination between the assimilation and elimination. It's great to be able to eat well, but if you're not eliminating, it doesn't matter. Mm-hmm. One of the best examples of this is the map of Israel. The water comes out in the mountains and down to the Sea of Galilee. Fish swim in the sea, birds fly over it, flowers grow around it, people live around it. And the same water goes down the Jordan River into the Dead Sea. Nothing lives in the Dead Sea. Birds don't even fly over it. There's nothing that can live around it. The only difference between the Sea of Galilee and the Dead Sea is elimination. The Dead Sea has no outlet. So if all we do physically is take in and don't eliminate properly, it dies. Mentally, if we do the same thing, it's a killer. If all you do is get knowledge and knowledge and knowledge and you don't use it, it's useless. And spiritually, it's the same thing. If all you do is give me prayers and you don't give it back out, it dies. You can't live without assimilation and elimination. They have to work. So if you breathe in and you don't breathe out, you don't get very far. So it's a whole basic concept of assimilation and elimination is part of keeping the body really healthy.
Maybe what you'd be giving to mothers, I think.
Well, one of the things that I think is so important is that the mother understands that holding her baby and rocking her baby and if she can, nursing her baby is so important to the underlying basic health of babies. I think we have a lot of neurotic people in our culture who have not been rocked or nursed or really held close to their mother's heart, because the baby feels and responds to the mother's heart. And if you look at the pictures of the Madonna, they almost always have the child on the left side. I don't know of any Madonna pictures that don't have the baby on the left side. The heart, the mother's heart. The baby feels and knows the mother's heart. And so it's that allowing that to happen and being aware that the baby needs to be held. When I started in medicine, women were propping the bottles. Actually, they didn't nurse their babies because they were being told that formula were just as good and maybe sometimes better because we knew what we were putting in and you didn't have any clue what the mother was putting in.
Yeah, right.
And so that they used all these different formulae, and they were told that they fed the baby every 4 hours. You didn't feed the baby when it was hungry, and you propped the bottle. They had these old bottle props where the baby went, you know, and you know, I used to talk myself blue in the face trying to get mothers to understand that it was a good thing to nurse your baby, that it was a good thing to hold your baby. And if a baby cried and needed to be held, it needed to be held. This was not spoiling the baby. Well, my parents were both osteopaths, and my granddaughter's in osteopathic school right now. And so the importance of structural work is vital. My daughter is a physical therapist. It's important to keep the body structure aligned and functional, because without that, it's very difficult for the life force to flow properly. I think that's one of the reasons yoga is also important. But chiropractic, myopractic, osteopathy, these are ways in which people involved in therapy have learned that they can help other people. And they're vital to, but there's so many different ways. I mean, the whole business of Reiki, therapeutic touch, the use of foot massage, mm-hmm. the use of acupuncture in the ears, you know. There, people find ways in which they can help other people, and I think that's so important.
Mm-hmm. As a mother, is there some way that if you don't have a lot of access to osteopaths, how could you help to assure that your child's physiology is your structure?
Well, of course, one of the things is to allow them to play and stretch and swing, and because children will do that naturally, and let them climb their trees and let them pull themselves up and encourage that sort of thing. And then the body massage that a mother can do is tremendously helpful. That's where the oils and so on come in too. Making sure that if a child is complaining of chest pain, that it's not, may not just be a cold. It may be that they just need to be stretched and allow themselves to stretch. One of the things that my parents did when we had respiratory problems was what we called the tummy shivers, which is this kind of a movement, which is actually a lymphatic pump, and gets the thymus activated. And back massages, there's just a wonderful way of working.
Now, what do you think about the increase in allergies, or maybe also it appears like increases in autism or ADD?
Oh boy, Heather, that's a big one, because I think that a lot of the environmental stuff that we do has to do with that. I think that the food additives that we have in our foods have to do with that. I think our children, we don't think they have malnutrition, but they do. They're not properly fed. All of these things are part of that whole process. It's a culturally evolving process that we're not addressing.
I'm wondering, part of what this teaching video is for, a teaching training center where we're trying to help to teach people to grow their own organic food,
yeah.
to do some of their own natural water purification, to be able to have physical exercise through doing gardening and so forth. What do you think about that?
I think the more we use artificial means, whether it's artificial means of growing things or artificial means of coloring foods or whatever, we're fooling ourselves. You know, the amount of sugar that we use, the amount of preservatives that are in foods, all of these things make for sick people. And our way of manifesting the sickness is different. The whole concept of vibratory medicine is all vibration anyway.
Exactly.
And the way we use colors and the way we use sound, our young people are really bombarded with all kinds of sounds. One of the reasons for some of our pathology is the sound over a stimulation that we have. You know, we have refrigerators that are going off all the time and TVs that are on all the time. All of these things is just an overstimulation of sound. Okay. And it doesn't just cause deafness, it causes a vibratory response in people. So that's absolutely true. And one of the things that I have worked with as far as my patients are concerned is the colors. If I have a person who comes in who's depressed or tends to be depressed and is wearing blacks and grays, I ask them please not to show up in my office in black or gray. They need to get some color into there. And if they don't want to wear it on the outside, at least wear some underwear that's colorful. Because the body and the spirit needs that.
Right.
Needs to be aware of the color. And I do ask them about what they listen to in the way of music. In fact, one of the things that I just told a person yesterday who tends to be really depressed was that she needs to start singing. And I don't care what her voice is like, you know. Aunt Belle used to say, I make a joyful noise unto the Lord, and she couldn't sing worth a darn. It was really pretty bad, but it was joyful.
And her heart was there.
Yeah.
I know you were one of the first people who also innovated, like created living programs where patients came in and lived for a while and had music therapy and art therapy and you know, color therapy and all kinds of dance therapy. How are you feeling about those kinds of
things? I think that, and it's happening more and more around the country. People are beginning to do that. It's what Casey called the Temple Beautiful Program, and basically a way of getting people away from their everyday stuck situations into a place where they can begin to reassess and reevaluate and reactivate their body, mind, and spirit, and then coordinate them. So yeah, it's you want to find a beautiful place where the environment is such, and the food is such, and the programs are such that they can sort of get a new handle on life, because we tend to get stuck in our own situation. We need to kind of reframe what our life is and where it's going.
Well, I think it's just so important, you know, with all the spas that are with us now. I think you were one of the first spa folks with all of the healers.
Yeah, we didn't call it that, but
for all the years that I have known you, I have seen you being the pioneer in virtually everything today. And I've seen you take it flat from the medical community, and I've seen it step by step by step by step becoming accepted.
And amazing.
And I personally want to thank you for the beautiful commitment that you've given with your whole life to the area. I want to thank you from all the mothers in the whole world. Thank you for all the gifts you've given to
us. It's been my privilege. It's really been my privilege and an honor. Thank you.
Dr. Gladys, I'd like to thank you for your courage.
Yes.
An example.
Thank you.
I've learned a lot from it. Hope to add myself.
Well, it wouldn't amount to a hill of beans if people didn't take it and run with it, you know, and go with it. And that's what you're doing, which is wonderful.
Thank you.
And such a mentor as you are, I'm hoping that you're mentoring this lovely man straight into all this integrated medicine.
That's the plan.
That's great. Yeah, that's great.